quantum theory as a whole is wrong. It's not Einstein was wrong. Quantum mechanics is wrong. Now, I say this very blatantly because it's a blatant topic. I mean, Einstein and Schrodinger were much more polite. They said it was incomplete.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Incomplete means wrong.
Well, you're telling it like it is.
Yeah, you've got to change it so it's wrong. But incomplete is a more polite way of saying it's wrong. Okay, they're fine. I should be polite sometimes too. To quantum mechanics, although it's pretty robust as it is. It doesn't mind people like me being rude to it. But anyway, so Einstein and Schrodinger both thought that it was wrong, that the theory needed some amendment, could be an important amendment, which changes the nature of the whole subject, quite likely.
So you think both Einstein's, both general relativity and quantum mechanics need to be modified, or primarily quantum mechanics? And a tinge to general relativity.
I would say, more importantly, quantum mechanics. You see, people sometimes say to combine these two great theories, you've got to quantize general relativity.
And can you explain, what does it mean to quantize?
You mean to haul it into the framework of quantum theory. So you have, you make it into a Hilbert space and operators and goodness know what.
And you sum over metrics. Or some over geometry.
Yeah, well, I mean, lots of people were trying to, Wheeler was trying to do that when I was in Princeton. Yeah, lots of people were trying to do that. Bryce DeWitt was certainly trying to do that.
And so when you speak to string theorists, they would say, well, that's quite obviously the approach. We're the only finite quantum gravity
game
in town.
They were trying to do that, yes. I mean, there's nothing wrong with quantizing gravity. It's just the weak, I don't know what I'd say. I'll read the right adjective. But, let me...
You don't have to be polite anymore.
No, I'm not trying to be polite here. I'm trying to be more illustrative of what I mean. I sometimes talk about a distant planet, which has an atmosphere on it. Just like, it's a planet very much like the Earth, almost identical. And these spaceship, there's a space probe going out to look at it because it's very interesting because it's just like the Earth. However, there is no life on it. No life has ever evolved on it. There are no butterflies to flap their wings, and weather is supposed to be a chaotic thing, and so even sensitive to the flapping of a butterfly's wing. There aren't any butterflies on this planet. There's no conscious beings on that planet. So all the different weathers that they might have on that planet are all coexist in superposition. It's a mess. The probe is going out to takes a photograph of this mess. It comes back to the Earth, and when it's within distance of being able to send signals to the Earth, somebody's sitting against the screen, and finally the first picture of the weather on that planet, this person looks at it, snap, his consciousness or her consciousness makes that world into one weather. What could be more absurd? Absolutely ridiculous. It's light years away. It doesn't have any interest in us. Why does its weather become one just because this chap hasn't taken a photograph of it? Absolute nonsense. I'm just trying to emphasize that I don't believe it is consciousness that collapses the wave function.
Instead, it's the collapse of the wave function that produces consciousness?
Well, that's my other story, which I think is another story, and is a story which I also try to pursue to some degree. I don't regard it as what I do most in my life, because it's too much biology and things like that, which I don't know anything about.
Are you wedded to microtubules being the mechanism or the place? Or are you just saying, look, if it's going to occur, it needs to occur somewhere in the brain. This chap named Stuart Hameroff put up his hand and say, it could be microtubules. I found this in the brain. And then you said, okay, well, maybe.
That's more or less it, yeah. Yes, it wasn't quite like that. But I do think microtubules are a good candidate for various reasons.
But you wouldn't be heartbroken if it turned out to be some other structure.
Heartbroken is too strong. I'd be a bit disappointed, yes.
Oh.
Because I think microtubules, no, there are various features of microtubules that I find fascinating. I don't think it's a coincidence.
Did you see the recent news about the super radiance in microtubules?
I did hear something. I didn't see it. Was that on the...
It said that there are quantum effects that are coherent in microtubules. Now,
yeah, there better be, yes.
Do you feel vindicated from that?
The trouble is I did look at the paper which was referred, I think it's, if it's the same one you're talking about, I did look at the paper Stewart is mentioned. There is a reference to his, but it doesn't really talk about his stuff. It looks like something else. I don't know. I might be connected. Look, I'm not a biologist, so I'm not even a chemist. I find chemists is too difficult for chemistry. It's full of words that I can't remember.
Yeah, same.
I was supposed to be a doctor. My parents were both doctors. They thought I should be a doctor. They were both medically trained. I was the one they thought would be the doctor. They won in the end because my little sister eventually got a doctor and she married one too. So they got two for the price of one. No, I disappointed them terribly. I would have been hopeless because I don't remember names, these things. You can tell, I forget them immediately. I'd have been putting the wrong prescription on people's...
Well, you invented quite a few. Bi twisters, dual twisters, alpha planes,
I remember
planes.
Them more... Well, yes, I remember most of those more easily, yes.
So I'm jumping ahead because the audience is familiar with that gravity has something to do with the collapse of the wave function.
Let me make that a little more specific.
Sure.
You see, I wasn't so clear on that until much more later, I think, around just a little before the turn of the century. I can't quite remember when. It took me a little while before I actually wrote the paper on it. I wrote a paper on it, which was to explain a conflict between the two basic principles, one of general relativity, the other of quantum mechanics. What's the basic principle of general relativity? It's the principle of equivalence, which Einstein admitted. Well, he didn't give Galileo credit. I think he should have given a reference to Galileo. I'm not sure he did. Because Galileo already noticed the principle of equivalence. And he talked about, I like the one of the fireworks. He says, he describes his fireworks, go out, and they make this beautiful sphere of sparks. As it falls, it remains a sphere. You can get rid of gravity by free fall, locally. I mean, he's very explicit. Not just the big rocks and the little rocks, and whether the feather doesn't because of air resistance and all that. I mean, he was right. But, of course, you needed special relativity and make that into a four-dimensional space-time, as Minkowski did, and then bend it as Einstein did.
So the collapse and gravity come in?
Nothing there. But my argument is that the principle of equivalence, which is the basis of general relativity, is in conflict with the principle of superposition. And the argument is more or less this. I say, think of an experiment done in a lab on a tabletop, and you want to take the Earth's gravitational field into consideration. Now, there are two ways you might do this. The way any sensible physicist would do it, you put a term in the Hamiltonian. If you don't know what that means, don't worry. Put a term in the Hamiltonian for the gravitational field and just chug away the usual procedures. Fine. Then you notice that Einstein's sitting in the corner, or Galileo even, and tell you, no. You shouldn't do it that way. The gravitational field of the Earth is locally just like free fall.
Mm-hmm.
So you can consider your lab, your coordinates are falling, and the lab is just accelerating in this thing. And there's no gravitational field. Okay, you do it this other way. It's a different way. Different coordinates, you do it away, and you come up, eventually, you come up with almost the same answer. The key, of course, is in the almost. The wave function you get, it's just the same, except for the complex multiplier, the phase factor,
right,
if you like, which people would quite like to discard, because when they're going to measure anything that you observe, they're taking amplitudes, you take squares of moduli. So you don't worry too much about that. Until you look rather too carefully at this actual factor, which is different between these two procedures, that actual factor involves the time, an exponential of the time cubed. And that is not that serious, if you really think of it. If you're thinking of quantum field theory, that's serious, because that's telling you that's a different vacuum. You're actually working in a different vacuum.
Just a moment. Don't go anywhere. Hey, I see you inching away. Don't be like the economy. Instead, read The Economist. I thought all The Economist was something that CEOs read to stay up to date on world trends. And that's true, but that's not only true. What I found more than useful for myself, personally, is their coverage of math, physics, philosophy, and AI, especially how something is perceived by other countries and how it may impact markets. For instance, The Economist had an interview with some of the people behind DeepSeek the week DeepSeek was launched. No one else had that. Another example is The Economist has this fantastic article on the recent dark energy data, which surpasses even Scientific American's coverage, in my opinion. They also have the chart of everything. It's like the chart version of this channel. It's something which is a pleasure to scroll through and learn from. Links to all of these will be in the description, of course. Now, The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means that you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments. I am personally interested in the more scientific ones, like this one on extending life via mitochondrial transplants, which creates actually a new field of medicine, something that would make Michael Levin proud. The Economist also covers culture, finance and economics, business, international affairs, Britain, Europe, the Middle East, Africa, China, Asia, the Americas, and of course, the USA. Whether it's the latest in scientific innovation or the shifting landscape of global politics, The Economist provides comprehensive coverage, and it goes far beyond just headlines. Look, if you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a new understanding, a deeper one, of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. I subscribe to them, and it's an investment into my, into your intellectual growth. It's one that you won't regret. As a listener of this podcast, you'll get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/toe, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now let's get back to the exploration of the mysteries of our universe. Again, that's economist.com/toe.